worthy. How many of you know he's worthy? He's created all things. In heaven and earth, under the earth, he's created it all. Everything is held up by the power of his word, or the word of his power. It's what the word of God says. So God is so good. I'm not worried about anything failing because of God. Because everything that happens, God's got it in control. Everything. The good and the bad. But so good to be in a house of God. Good God. See Betty Norman, my good friend, visiting with us tonight. No more for you. Good to have Tangy and Terry's dad here. Praise the Lord. Amen. Praise God for that. Praise the Lord. Isn't God good? Did you have a good evening? Praise the Lord. I'm not going through all the announcements tonight. You have to go back and get them off the morning program if you need to hear them. But we're just going right into the Word of God tonight and into the worship service. And we're going to see what God has for us through Sister Tangy.
Amen.
She's ministering the Word of God. And so I think one day she's going to make a preacher. I believe. I believe she will one day. So anyway, I'm picking at you, Tangy. But is everybody all right? Anybody got a prayer request? Very quickly, we did not get this morning anywhere. Praise the Lord, nothing else happened today. Isn't that good?
Amen.
That's a miracle, brother. Praise God. Stand all over the house. If you have an offering, you just put it in one of the two pans behind the middle benches here. And we'll get a hold of it before we get out of here tonight. We just want to pray that God is going to have his way in this house. You hear me, church? Not my way. Not your way, not even Tangy's way. We want God's way in this house tonight. So let's pray. Father, in the name of Jesus, we come unto you tonight, praising you and glorifying your name, worshiping you in this house tonight, magnifying the Holy God of heaven, lifting up your name tonight, Father. We need you in this house. We bless your name. We thank you for every family and every home that's come through the doors of this church. God, touch our sick and afflicted. You know who they are, Father. You know each individual, and remember those that are in the hospitals and those, Lord, that are traveling and all the situations that are taking place. We're lifting them up before you tonight, God. Heal, deliver, and set free. We magnify you one more time in this house, God. Bless our singers and our musicians tonight and anoint them and use them in this house tonight, we pray. In Jesus' mighty name. Let's worship tonight. Join in with me.
Yeah.
do it. You want it?
Praise the Lord. It's a mighty one of Israel. Amen. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Glory to God.
It's good to be here tonight. Hallelujah. It's good spirit in the house tonight. It's good to see everyone that's come out tonight. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. God is good. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Hallelujah. Glory to God. We're going to get right into the scriptures tonight, if you'll stand for the reading of the word. The title of my message tonight is Faith Tested by Fire. Hallelujah. After I get through reading, I'm going to go into a short video. It's about 2.5 minutes. And it'll give you a visual of what this might have looked like. Hallelujah. Daniel 3:14-1a, and then we'll read Revelations 12:11. Nebuchadnezzar spake and said unto them, Is it true, O Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego? Do not ye serve my gods, nor worship the golden image which I have set up? Now, if ye be ready, that at what time ye hear the sound of the cornet, the flute, the harp, the sackbut, the psaltery, and the dulcimer, and all kinds of music, ye fall down and worship the image which I have made. Well, but if ye worship not, ye shall be cast the same hour into the midst of a burning, fiery furnace. And who is that God? Who is that God that shall deliver you out of my hands? Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego answered and said to the king, O Nebuchadnezzar, we're not careful to answer thee in this matter. If it be so, our God, whom we serve, is able to deliver us from the burning fiery furnace, and he will deliver us out of thine hand, O king. But if not, be it known unto thee, O king, that we will not serve thy gods, nor worship the golden image which thou hast set up. And Revelations 12:11 says, and they overcame him by the blood of the Lamb, and by the word of their testimony, and they loved not their lives unto the death. Amen.
Yeah, turn it up.
Between all the things you see and expect to be.
fire, because who you go through the fire with will determine how your outcome, how you're going to end up. Amen. Who you go through the fire, you've got to have a made up mind, Crystal. Yes. You've got to know in whom you believe in. Amen. Before you get to that point, hallelujah. Glory to God. Glory to God. Although Jesus had not yet been born, he had not walked on the earth, he had not died on the cruel cross, and he hadn't risen from the grave yet, he was in the fire that day. Amen. The Messiah to come, the Lamb slain before the foundations of the world. Hallelujah. He was, he is, and he is to come. Hallelujah. He is coming back. Heart, hallelujah, who Jesus is. He is the King. He is the Lord. I don't have any doubt tonight. I know in whom I have believed. Do you know tonight in whom you have put your trust and your faith and your hope in tonight? Hallelujah. Because he's getting ready to split the eastern sky. He's getting ready to step out again, and he's going to blow that trumpet, and he's going to call his children home. Are you ready to go tonight? I know that I am. Hallelujah. Lord of Lords, I'm excited tonight. I am so excited about God coming back and him returning. I know there's a people out there that aren't looking, but I'm looking, and I'm excited, and I know, I believe every word of the scriptures. I've read it from the beginning to the end. Brother Sean, we've read it from the beginning to the end. We know how it all wraps up, don't we? Hallelujah. And it won't be long. It won't be long, church. I'm here to encourage somebody's soul tonight and let you know that Jesus is coming back. Jesus is coming back. Just hold on. Don't give up. Don't you give in. Don't you bow tonight. Don't you bow tonight. Hallelujah. The King of Kings is on his way, church. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Glory to God. I told Terry I was excited about this message. All of us preachers get excited when we get to preach about the fiery furnace, hallelujah, and how our God delivers us. Amen. We all get all excited about this scripture. Amen. My last sermon, I preached just a little bit in there about Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego and how God delivered them. And I said, well, Lord, I don't know, because you know I've already given out some, but I haven't given out the whole story, Sister Luke. We got chapter 3, verse 1 through verse 30. So we're going to go through all of them. But I promise you I won't read all 30 of them tonight. Amen. Glory to God. Sister Luke told me I've got about 2 hours tonight, so I won't keep you past 2 hours tonight. Amen. Glory to God. But we're going to start out in Daniel... before the fire, Daniel 3, it goes from 1 through 20. This is before the fire. We're going to look at before the fire, in the midst of the fire, and then after the fire. And then we're going to talk about that all-consuming fire tonight. Amen. King Nebuchadnezzar, he was the king of Babylon, and it is believed that there were about 20 years between chapters 2 and 3. Chapter 2, Daniel would interpret the king's dream of a statue with the head of it being gold. And he would tell the king this represented him and his kingdom. So now we see in chapter 3 where he has an image that's made of gold, and it's set up in the plain of Dura in the province of Babylon. Now his height was 80, which is about 60 cubits, and it was width was 6 cubits. Roughly this was about 90 feet tall and 10 feet wide. That's a big statue, y'all. Think about the buildings just downtown. When you stand up next to one and you look up, think about how tall that statue was that they had, that he had placed there that day. They said it was probably set up on the base. They're not sure if this image was of Nebuchadnezzar, but most people agree that this was an image of Nebuchadnezzar that was set up on a platform, and his statue would go up high. Now, I want y'all to think about Brother Claude and how tall. What, about 6 feet? A little bit more? Think about how many Brother Claude's we have stacked up and looked up to him. I mean, that's just 6 feet right there. Think about how tall, 90 feet tall. That was a large statue. Amen? This would have been a very impressive sight in the plain of Dura for all to see, both near and far, for everybody. Y'all hold on just a minute. Amen. Amen. The reason for setting up the golden image was to display the power and the authority and the wealth of the king's kingdom. This was to demonstrate the splendor and the dominance of Nebuchadnezzar's empire. Amen? Yeah. Also, this was to compel all those in his kingdom to bow down and to worship this image as a symbol of loyalty and submission to his authority. This use of elaborate displays of wealth and power to intimidate and control subjects was not uncommon in ancient empires. Intimidation was used to cause fear so that they could get them to bow down, that they would fear them more than they would God, that they would fear what could happen if they did not follow, if they did not bow down, Crystal. And that's exactly what we see is happening today. The government is trying to place fear inside of us and cause us to bow down. But you have to have a made up mind tonight that you're not going to bow, that you're not going to give in, because you have read the book and you know in whom you have believed in tonight. Yes. You got to be determined not to give in to the new movements that are out there, the LGBT movement that's out there, the gay and lesbian lifestyle. It is not of God. And we as Christians are not, we're supposed to love everybody, right? We're supposed to love everything that they do, right? Is that right? We're just supposed to welcome it right on it. That is a false teaching. We are to love them, but we're to tell them the truth, because if we truly love them, we will tell them the truth of God's word. If somebody is out there in the middle of the road and you see a big semi-truck and they're running this way and it's behind them and they don't know because they have some headphones on their ears, are you going to stand there and just say, I love you, brother, just keep on going, and that truck comes down that road and kills them? Or would you run out there and do everything you could and warn them of the danger that's coming, regardless to what it costs you, regardless to what you've got to do? You've got to tell the truth. You cannot give in. This new woke moment that's out there, everything that's happening right now, all of it's to cause fear, Sister Luke. The AI, our pastor has told us all about it so we would be warned, but we are not to fear it.
Right.
We are not to fear what is coming on this earth. And if you are sold out to God, you don't have to fear, because you're not going to be left behind. You're going to be going in the rapture. We don't have to worry about what's coming. Hallelujah. Glory to God. The image that's talked about in Revelations, the last 3.5 years, that's when the image of the beast will be set up. That's when you will be told that you had to take the mark of the beast. But that is when you were left behind. That is if you were left behind. I do not believe. I am one that believes that the church will not be here when that takes place. When the rise of the Antichrist comes on the scene. If you are covered by the blood of Jesus, his blood is more than enough to set us free. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Glory to God. The king commands that all of the princes and the governors and the captains, the judges, the treasurers, the counselors, the sheriffs, and all of the real rulers of the province to come to the dedication of the statue. And then a herald would cry out loud and say, to you it is commanded, O people, nations, language, that at what time you hear the sound of the cornet, the flute, the harp, the sackbut, the psaltery, the dulcimer, and all kinds of music, you're to fall down and you're to worship this golden image. And anyone that would not fall down and worship this image, they would be cast in the fiery burning furnace. Hallelujah. Now I want to go back here and I want you to look at all of these. These are heads. These are leaders. These are those that are in charge. Let me tell you something. The reason why the enemy is trying to take out our pastors and our leaders and all of those that are in our government, if they can get a hold of them, if they can get them to bow, what do you think the people are going to do?
That's right.
What do you think the people are going to do? That's why the enemy is wanting to take out the heads. That's why the enemy, you think about the music industry. When all of this is, as soon as you play the music, there's a sound, a a wicked sound, an evil sound when the enemy plays the music. There's such a different sound. You have to have a discerning ear to know the difference between good godly music, worship music, because if not, you're going to be drugged away by the sound of the enemy's music. And you're going to end up violent tonight. Hallelujah. You've got to know the difference. Hallelujah. Glory to God. I want to show you something. I'm going to show you a video real quick. Because my mother said this to me, and I took just 1 minute and 5 seconds because I wanted you to see something that's out there. Because there's many worship leaders that are out there. They're starting off in church, and they're giving themselves over to all of this worldly music. But you're going to see how it's happening. Go ahead and play that for me for just a minute, Terry. Hallelujah.
Gone are those days when worship was a sacred communion between the soul and the divine, a time when the air was thick with reverence and the hymns were a heartfelt cry to the heavens. The church used to be a sanctuary, a place where the world's noise faded away, leaving only the profound silence in which you could hear God's whisper. But now, that silence is filled with the beats of secular music, and the sacred space feels more like a stage than a sanctuary.
What we have done is we have elevated music to, it seems to be a place above the teaching of the scripture.
That's what's out there, church. You wonder why people are leaving the church, because they're listening to the sound of the world. And they're trying to bring it into the churches tonight. That did not cause you to have a grieving spirit inside of you after you watched that, knowing that that was Michael Jackson, but yet that was supposed to be a choir director. That's who's leading our young people. That's who's in our churches out there. This isn't just one church. This is out there in many churches. This is worldly music, and if you're not careful, you will be drugged away.
Right.
You will bow down. Maverick, the city, many of you have heard of that worship leader. And if you know it, if you've read anything, he has given himself over to secular music. Most of us know this group. He's a very popular guy. And woe unto him. He is going to lead so many souls, so many young people that are following after him. And he said he wanted to go out there where there was more of an audience. There was more of a following that would follow after him. He started out a good godly man, Christian man, singing worship. But more and more, he got pulled out into the world. And now he's bowed his knee to Satan himself. He has given himself over. Be careful, church, what you listen to and who you listen to. Make sure that you know tonight. It is very important, because it is very easy. The enemy said, or the Bible tells us, the enemy will use deception in these last days. He is looking to deceive even the very elect. If it be possible, it said that he would deceive and he would pull out. But how many young people are selling out? How many people are following tonight? Amen. Amen. The heads in the churches and our pulpits, I saw this man and his wife. They had gone to a hotel, and in front of their child, the pastor shot his wife and shot himself, although it didn't kill him. He did shoot them, and it's because of an affair, and found out later on that this pastor had been abusing his wife. That's what's in our pulpits. That's not just one story, Brother Claude. That's the ones that are up here that are proclaiming the name of Jesus. They're telling that, yes, I follow after Christ. And then when they leave the pulpit, they're out there committing every kind of sin that's out there. And that's what we're following after. That's what we're being led by. If you don't have anything different when you come into the churches, if you don't have anything to look up to, if all you have, you're going to be led astray. Be very careful. Be very careful. Amen. Amen. When the music played, all the people would fall down and worship the golden image, all except for Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. It said all fell down and worshiped, except for three. Think about that. Where would your heart have been that day? Where would you have been that day? Would you have just followed along because everybody else was going to do it, you know? I'm telling you right now, you've got to have a made-up mind that you're going to stand for Christ no matter what, no matter if you have to do it all alone, no matter if anybody in your family is standing for Christ, that you're going to stand up for what is right. You have to have a made-up mind tonight. Amen. Glory to God. The Chaldeans would accuse the Jews to the king. Satan, our enemy, he's the accuser of the brethren. He accuses us day and night before God, Sister Lou. Day and night he accuses us, but praise God, we've overcome by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of our testimony that the blood of the Lamb covers our sins, though they be as scarlet or washed white as snow. Amen. The Chaldeans would go and they would tell the king, the Jews that you've set over the affairs of the province of Babylon, these men regard not your gods, nor worship the golden image. Satan's goal in the life of every believer is to prevent, to disrupt, and to cut off his relationship with God. He does not want us to have a relationship with God. Because he knows his end. He will never be able to get back in. And he is determined to destroy you, Sister Cindy. He wants to do anything and everything. He planned to divide the two of you, Brother Justin and Sister Cindy. He tried to take you out this weekend, but praise God, you're covered by the blood of the Lamb. Praise God, you are covered by the blood of the Lamb. Nothing formed against you. Hallelujah. That's just the car out there. God will give you back even better. I believe in Jesus' name. He's not only going to repair it, but he's going to give you better than you had before. Amen?
Amen.
Glory to God. Because that's the kind of God that we serve. The devil, he prowls around like a roaring lion. You hear what I said? He is like a roaring lion. There is only one Lion of Judah. Hallelujah. His name is Jesus. Glory to God. He's like a roaring lion, and he's looking to devour you. But if you will just stand up and say, no, devil, I ain't listening to you. I ain't going to pay you attention because I know who I am. Crystal, you are blessed and highly favored of the Lord. You are a daughter of the Most High God. You belong to the King of Kings, and the devil ain't got no hold on you anymore, girl. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Woo. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Satan's only real power throwing our past and our sins, our transgressions in our face. He's the accuser. That's what he's supposed to do. But praise God for the sacrifice of Jesus Christ. His sacrifice has effectively dealt with the problem. His blood redeems us. It sets us free from the slavery of our sins and Satan's control. Satan no longer has control over us. Our past no longer has control over us. My Bible tells me that whom the Son sets free is free indeed. Hallelujah. Whom the Son sets free is free indeed. We're no longer bound. Amen. This would make the king furious. He was very angry, and he would command that Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego would be brought to him. And the king says, is this true, that you do not serve my gods, nor worship the golden image that I have set up? Do you get that? I? The king says, well, I'm going to give you a second chance to fall down and worship. I'm going to give you a second chance to worship the image that I've set up, that I've made, but if not, you shall be cast the same hour into the midst of the fiery furnace. The enemy is always giving us another chance. He's always, day and night, he's coming after us. It's not just a second and a third time that he's going to come after you, Brother Sean, and try to pull you off that fire. He's going to try to get you off. He's going to try to get you to do whatever he can do to get you to quit and not follow after the call. But God says, I've called you out, brother. I've set you apart for such a time as this. And whom the Son sets free, remember, you are free. No matter what you got to go through, brother, it's worth it all. No matter what you got to go through, it's worth it all. In the end, hallelujah, because we know at the end, God wins. Amen.
Yes, yes,
you
amen.
Keep going. You keep pursuing. God's got a great work for you, brother.
Yes, amen.
He's got many souls for you to lead into the kingdom. He's got a great call, a great anointing. I feel it. He's taking you places. Right now, he's preparing you. But he's got a great work for you. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Then he says, who is that God that shall deliver you out of my hands? He had no idea what to call. At that moment, he didn't know what he was saying. Who is that God? Matthew 4:7 says, Jesus said, it is written, thou shalt not tempt the Lord thy God. This was when Jesus was being tempted in the wilderness by Satan. Know this, God does not have to prove himself to any one person.
Amen.
By the response given, we see that Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego were well aware of this, that God did not have to save them from the fire to prove that he was God. They already had a made-up mind. They already believed in the God of Abraham, of Isaac, and of Jacob. They had already seen, Sister Luke, all the miracles. They already made up their mind that they believed. Yeah. They've seen too much. They heard too much. They knew too much. Amen?
Yeah.
Glory to God. I've seen too much. I've heard too much, and I know too much. Hallelujah. I'm not turning back. I've come too far.
Yeah.
I'll turn back now. Hallelujah. Is there anybody else in the house tonight that has come too far to turn back now?
Woo! Yes.
Yeah.
Glory to God. No matter what we got to go through. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. God did not save them from the fire because of the king's word that day. But God saved them from the fire because of their faith. That whether they lived or died, they knew that God would deliver them from the hand of the enemy. Hallelujah. The response given by Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego was this: we are not careful to answer thee in this matter. In other words, we don't have to give any thought to what you have asked us. We have already made up our minds who we are going to serve. It is either yes or no. It's black and white for me. I don't know about you. It's either a yes, I will serve him, or no.
Come
you
on.
Don't have time
Come
to sit on the fence. I've said it every time I get up here. Now keep on. Sister Ariana, you don't have time to sit on the fence. It's either a yes or a no. You are either hot or either you're cold. You don't have time to be lukewarm because God's getting ready to spit you out of his mouth. Amen. He's coming for a bride that is ready and looking, who has their lamps filled with oil. Do you know that today? God is coming back for a bride that is ready, that is pure and without spot and without blemish today. He is coming for somebody who is looking for him. Somebody who has with him. He's not coming for somebody who's all in today and tomorrow they're all out. He is coming for a bride that wants to be with him. He is not going to make you be with him.
Amen.
He's not going to make you do it. Hallelujah, because that's who our God is. He sent his son on a cruel cross to die for your sins. He's made a way, but you have to make the choice. Do you want him? He says, I've done everything that you need. Everything that you need, Daniela. He said, I've already done it for you. I did it over 2,000 years. I provided the sacrifice that was needed. Hallelujah. I hung, I bled, and I died just for you. And I'm coming back. Hallelujah. What will you say? Will you say, yes, Lord? Hallelujah. Sister Johnny, will you say, yes, Lord? Yes, Lord. Come quickly, Lord. I'm ready to go home tonight. I'm ready to go home tonight. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Glory to God. Hallelujah. They say, if it be so, our God whom we serve is able to deliver us from the burning fiery furnace, and he will deliver us out of thy hand, O King. But if not, be it known unto thee, O King, that we will not serve thy gods nor worship the golden image which thou hast set up. God is more than able to deliver you tonight. He said, they had no doubt. You can't have any doubt in God's word. He is able to heal. He is able to deliver. And he is able to set free. But if not, you have got to be determined that you're not going to bow down, that you're not going to give in, Sister Johnny, regardless to what it looks like, to whatever you have to go through. Hallelujah. And whether you live, whether you die, as long as you belong to Jesus,
yes.
You know, you said it, sister, you testified. You said, I know where I'm going. I have no doubts. Hallelujah. Yeah. Glory to God. Yeah. I know you're able to deliver me, God, but if not, I will not bow. I will not bow. Hallelujah. Daniel 3:21-25. This is where the king would have Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego thrown into the fire. He's furious. He's angry because they refused once again to bow. And so he would go and he would heat up that fiery furnace 7 more times hotter than it was. He would have them, they were fully dressed. And he would throw them, Brother Warren, into the midst of the fire. Why did he throw them in fully dressed? I read because he wanted to make sure that they would burn and burn quickly. And he wanted to get rid of them as fast as he could. It was really the enemy. The enemy is doing everything and anything he could do. He wants to get rid of those who truly believe, who truly stand up for their faith, because they might be a little bit contagious. It might rub on somebody else. Hallelujah. If he can't get rid of us, glory to God. But sister, brother, Cindy, Justin, Brother Justin, just like you, every time I come in, the enemy's trying to take you out because I don't know how y'all can just sit there when you see our brother up here worshiping. That's true worship. He's excited about what God's done in his life. And I don't know about y'all, but that just rubs off on me a little bit. That gets me just a little bit excited. Amen. Glory to God. But the enemy wants to destroy us because he doesn't want going around. Because it might bring somebody else into the kingdom, Crystal. Hallelujah. It might get somebody else delivered. Amen. Glory to God. So that's why the enemy wants to destroy us tonight. But he ain't going to win.
Amen.
He's not going to win. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Glory to God. The men that the king would have them throw into the midst of the fire, Brother Sean, these were the most mighty men of King Nebuchadnezzar's army that day. The most mightiest men it doesn't matter how strong you are, doesn't matter how much you have, God, that own consuming fire, the fire that was inside of that fiery furnace that day would never be able, the might of men could not stand up to it. I don't care who you are. I don't care how mighty you are. No one will be able to stand up under the presence and the glory of God.
Yes, amen.
Those men were completely destroyed that day. They were completely destroyed. They were consumed. The sad part is that was just the beginning of their torment. What they felt that day in the fire. Hell's a real place. And if you don't know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, the torment those men would feel, it wasn't quick for them that day. There's many that are slipping into hell every single day.
Amen.
Every day hell is enlarging itself. Every day. And if you close your eyes, if you're in here tonight and you don't know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, hear me and hear me well. This will be your end. It's torment. It's pain. That was sad when you think about those men. The king had go and throw in Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego that day. They lost their lives for all eternity. They would burn for all eternity. We may not have ever seen them. They may have been burned up in front of their eyes. But what a horrible place many are opening their eyes to because they turned their backs on God. They will not heed. They will not listen. They will not open up their hearts. Sister Luke's preached. I've preached from Luke 19 many times about the rich man and Lazarus. Many of us know the story. It's real. Hell is real. Many preachers will not preach on hell today, but this preacher will preach on hell to the day I die because I don't want to see anyone go there. It was not created for you and I. The Lord doesn't want any of us to go there. That's why he died for us. He did not die to save us from hell, Brother Sean. That's not why Jesus died on the cross, Sister Lou. He died to save us from our sins. He died to restore our relationship that was once broken from our Heavenly Father, to restore that relationship back. For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in Him would not perish, but have everlasting life.
Amen. Yes.
Verse 23 says that Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego would fall down bound in the midst of the fire. Now, why they fell down, it does not say. Maybe it was because they were cast in there, but maybe, just maybe, they fell down, Sister Luke, and worshiped when they saw who was in the midst of the fire that day. What will you do? What would you do when you were thrown into the fire and Jesus is inside of there? What would you do? Would you be able to stand, Crystal? Oh, hallelujah. Will you be able to sing? Will you be able to speak at all? Oh, I can only imagine, Brother Warren, what that day will be like. Hallelujah. King Nebuchadnezzar was taken by surprise. He would rise up in haste and ask his counselors, did not we just cast three men that were bound? That were bound in the midst of the fire? They said, well, true, O king. He says, but I see four men in the fire.
Yes.
They're no longer bound, and they're walking in the presence of the Almighty. The fourth man was in the fire with Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. You are covered. When you are covered, you can walk with Jesus. Hallelujah. You can be in His presence and not be consumed. Hallelujah. It's the protective fire of God. The protective fire of God. There's the fire of judgment, but then there's the fire that protects us from our enemies, that keeps us safe, that overshadows us. He's a very present help in times of trouble. He's a strong tower that we can run to, Sister Crystal. Hallelujah. Sister Heidi, we can run to Him at a moment's notice and know that He will cover us and keep us. Hallelujah. We don't have to fear today. We don't have to fear anything that's happening all around us because of God, because He will protect us. That's His word. He said He would cover us. He would keep us. He would never leave us. He would never forsake us. Hallelujah. Sister Betty, He'll never leave you. He'll never forsake you. Amen. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Jesus, Messiah, the Lamb of God, the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, the all-consuming fire was in the midst of the burning fiery furnace that day. The one who heals, delivers, and sets free. Another reason why God delivered the three Hebrew boys that day was to show that His people that He was still the God that goes before them and He protects them from their enemies. Hallelujah. That He had not let them, even though they had turned their backs on them, on Him, even though they had fallen into sin, amen, their transgressions, God was with them and He would still protect them. He would take care of His people. He would come and rescue His people, amen. Many times I should have died. Many times I should have been taken out for the things that I did. There are so many things that I did that I'm ashamed of. Things that I allowed into my life. And I should be dead. But praise God, He covered me. He kept me anyway when I was away from Him. He still kept me. Because God knew my future was greater than my past. Amen. He knew who I was going to be. From that God, that God to the Most High God. Amen. Glory to God. Notice how he changed real quick. Amen. The princes and the governors and the captains, the kings, the counselors, they were all there that day, and they would witness these men coming out of the fire. The fire had no power over them, nor was a hair of their head singed, neither were their coats changed, nor the smell of the fire was on them. The all-consuming fire had protected them that day. This furnace was still burning when the king came near, and yet the king was not burned up. Why? Why was he not burned up? I believe it was because of the decree that he would make in verse 29. It was a decree that said, every people, every nation and language would speak anything amiss against the God of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego shall be cut in pieces, and their houses shall be made a dunghill, because there is no other God that can deliver after this sort. Amen. Hallelujah. He would be the very one that would decree and declare among all of them, nobody could speak against the God of the three Hebrew boys. Amen.
Yeah,
nobody could speak against the one and true living God. Since he had the kingdom, since he had the power, everyone had to bow. Everyone had to take charge after him and listen to him. And then look at what happens next. They would be promoted by the king. Amen.
Amen.
Only a faith that has stood the test of the fire of the cloth. Faith tested by fire, amen. They came through the fire and then God elevated them. We got to go through some things, amen, so that we know that we know that we know that we will not bow down. Elevated them. We got to go through some things that our faith will not waver, amen. God just wanted somebody else to hear that. Whatever you got to go through, we got to go through some things, amen. Glory to God. We got to go through some things. But we got to get to a place, church, where our faith will not waver.
Amen.
It doesn't change, and it doesn't just because we get sick, just because we have to go through something.
That's right.
We should still remain the same.
Amen.
It cannot change, no matter if we're standing before a fiery furnace, no matter if we're going through something really, really hard. We have to remain the same because people are watching us. They want to see that what you've got is different than what the world has. They got to understand that peace, when you're on your job and you everybody else thinks you should be falling apart, you've got that peace that passes all understanding. Amen?
Yes, amen.
Can't be explained by the world. That's what the world needs. They need to see that our God is real. That we serve not a dead God, but a living God.
Yes.
A God,
amen,
that is alive and well tonight. Amen.
Amen.
Glory to God. Glory to God. Amen. Glory to God. Give you real quick. The all-consuming fire of God. God's holiness is the reason for his being a consuming fire. And it burns up anything that's unholy. The holiness of God is that part of his nature that most separates him from sinful man.
Yes. Yes.
In the Old Testament, the concept of God as an all-consuming fire is mentioned in several places, but in Deuteronomy 4:24, for the Lord your God, it says, is a consuming fire, a jealous God. This verse points out God's holiness, his power, and the idea that he should be revered and worshiped with utmost devotion and purity. Before the fire, the king had no problem speaking against the God of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. But after the fire, he made that decree that all would be killed if they spoke against their God, that no God could deliver like our God. Amen?
Amen.
In the New Testament, the all-consuming fire is mentioned in Hebrews 12. And you read in 26 through 29 where it talks about that everything that can be shaken will be shaken. But we are inheriting a kingdom that cannot be shaken.
Amen.
He is. In Hebrews 12 and 29, it says, for our God is a consuming fire, and everything, all sin, every evil and wicked thing will be burned up. And only those things that are not burned up, only those things that are left standing, will be left to inherit that unshakable kingdom, that kingdom that cannot be moved. Amen. There's a kingdom coming that will be eternal, that will be everlasting. The image of God as an all-consuming fire shows his purifying and refining nature, as a fire is often associated with purification and judgment in biblical symbolism. It serves as a reminder of God's power, his holiness, and the need for a close, reverent relationship with him. Those who pursue evil and turn their backs on God will be consumed. We've seen it in the Old Testament in Sodom and Gomorrah. That consuming fire that came down and burned up the whole city. The whole city took them out, that all consuming fire. That's the judgment and the wrath. It's coming upon this earth once again, and you don't want to be here when it comes. If you read the book of Revelation, you know what's coming on this earth. You don't want to be here during that time. It's going to be a time that people are going to be fearful seeing what's coming upon this earth. Their hearts will fail them for what's coming on this earth.
Yes. Amen.
Jesus is Savior now, but he's coming back as judge. Yes. You don't want to be here. At the end of the Great Tribulation period, after church has gone on, but at the end of this period, 2 Thessalonians 1:7 through 9 says that the Lord Jesus shall be revealed from heaven with his mighty angels in a flaming fire, taking vengeance on them that know not God and that obey not the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, who shall be punished with everlasting destruction from the presence of the Lord and from the glory of his power. The only thing that's good is God.
Yes.
His presence, his glory, his power.
Yes.
I don't want to feel it as the wrath of God. I don't want to be in that part of it. Our God's a good God. He's a loving God. He deserves our reverent fear. Honor. He's worthy of all praise, of all glory. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Amen. Conclusion tonight, everyone will face the fire of God, whether it's the fire of judgment and wrath, or the refiner's fire, that protective fire. The choice is yours tonight. The choice is yours tonight. There is a fiery furnace that every living soul that dies without Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior, they will be cast into. This is that lake of fire that you read about in Revelations 19, chapters 19 through 20. 20:15 says this, and whosoever was not found written in the Lamb's book of life will be cast in the lake of fire. This is that false prophet, the beast. Death and hell, the devil, all who receive the mark of the beast at the end of the last 3.5 tribulation period. If you don't serve him now, you probably will not serve him then. There will be very few, mostly the Jews. That's a time for the Jews to come in. That time, that tribulation period, for those who are still waiting on their Messiah, this is when they will come in. Faith tested by fire when we are persecuted and endure hard times because of our Christian faith, yet continue to serve God. The genuineness of our faith is revealed. 1 Peter 1:6-7 says, wherein you greatly rejoice, though now for a season, if need be, ye are in heaviness through manifold temptations, that the trial of your faith, being much more precious than of gold that perisheth, though it be tried with fire, might be found unto praise and honor and glory at the appearing of Jesus Christ. How did Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego overcome? How do we as the believers overcome? By the blood of the Lamb and the word of our testimony, and not loving our life even unto the death. Remember that God will take you through the fire. God's presence as an all-consuming fire, it protects us, it guides us, it purifies us, those who trust in him. Tonight, my heart is to encourage you not to bow. Do not bow to the things that you see happening around you when the government tells us we need to stop coming to church. I'm so glad we have a pastor who has opened the doors, who will continue to go on.
Yeah.
She will not back down. She will not give up. She will not pull on that pew. God's anointed you for such a time as this, Sister Lou. I thank God for you your ministry and for all that you do, because I know how much you go through, and I know how much the enemy attacks you and he tries to destroy you and he tries to take you out. But God's called you for such a time as this. And just like he couldn't take out Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego before it was their time, he can't take you out either. That devil cannot take you out. God has placed you here. He has placed you in the heaven on earth. And you're not going to go anywhere unless God says so. Amen. Glory to God. I speak it out loud, and I want the devil to hear it. I want every devil of hell to hear it tonight. Hallelujah. Our pastor ain't going nowhere. She's covered by the blood of the Lamb. God, glory to God. Lord knows we still need you, Sister Luke. He ain't going to let you go nowhere.
Right.
Amen. Amen. And I mean that with everything inside of me.
Amen.
You're not just needed, Sister Luke. You're wanted.
Love.
Love you very, very much.
Yes.
Very, very blessed to be under your leadership and all that you do. Because you showed me so many things. Many, many times I wanted to give up and I want to walk away. And you said, no, you can't do it. I didn't want to get up here and preach. There's times that you probably should have never let me back up here, but you still let me get back up here. From the bottom of my heart, thank you. Thank you. Hallelujah. Many of us ministers could say thank you because we don't get this privilege to be able to stand up here and give out the word. There's a lot of pastors that they want that. They're hungry for it. Thank you. Amen. I don't say that to lift you up, but I say that to lift God up and to give him the glory.
That's right.
Amen.
I give him the glory for you, for your life. And you will be rewarded greatly one day. You may not see it this side of heaven, but you will be rewarded greatly for the service, for all that you've given. Remember that God will take you through the fire. God's presence as an all-consuming fire protects us. Stand up for truth and what is right, no matter the cost. Be reminded that our God is more than able to deliver, and that he will deliver us from the hand of the enemy. Keep fighting, pressing on. Don't give up. Don't back down no matter the cost. Fight for your family.
Amen.
Fight for your loved ones. Fight for your co-workers.
Yes.
Fight for your friends. Fight for your neighbor.
Amen.
Their very life could depend on your faithfulness. Every single one of you that's here tonight, God's depending on you to tell some lost soul about Jesus. God's depending on you, Sister Cheryl, to pray like never before. He's calling on us to pray, to seek his face, to be his hands, to be his arms, to be his feet. He could come down here. He could do it all, but he's chosen to use us.
Right.
Willing vessels, those that will yield and say, yes, Lord, I'll go.
Amen.
Yes, Lord, I'll do whatever the call, whatever it costs me. Don't let your faith waver. Stand up in the face of the enemy and watch that enemy flee.
Yes. Amen.
Amen. Remember 1 Corinthians 1:18 that says, for the preaching of the cross is to them that perish foolishness, but unto us which are saved, it is the power of God. You can stand to your feet tonight. God gave you the song to play tonight. It's called Through the Fire by the Crab Family. This word ministered to me, the words of this song. And I believe this word is for somebody specifically of this song. Probably many of us in here can identify with the words of this song. Let it be a word from God to you tonight to not give up. It says he never promised that the cross would not get heavy and the hill would not be hard to climb. He never offered our victories without fighting, but he said help would always come in time. Just remember when you're standing in the valley of decision and the adversary says give in, just hold on. Our Lord will will show us, and he will take us through the fire again. If that's you tonight, come and get in these altars tonight, and let's turn on this worship tonight, hallelujah, and worship the Lord tonight. Get out and make a stand for God and let him know no matter what you got to go through, I will not bow to the enemy. I will only bow to the one true and living God tonight. Hallelujah. Glory to God.
So many times I've questioned certain circumstances or things I could not understand.